Amen. Amen. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
What day is this? And I'll let. Amen, amen, amen. We have a scripture this morning that is coming from a familiar text. Amen. Many of you probably don't even have to open your Bibles. Psalms 23. Anybody know anything about that? Oh, y'all too quiet this morning. That's all right. Amen. Psalms 23. Amen. Many people know the Psalms, but it's a blessing when you know the shepherd. Oh, y'all will get that later. Amen. Psalms 23, and it says, "The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anoints my head with oil. My cup runneth over. All the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Amen. Amen. May we pray. Father God, we come in the precious name of Jesus. Lord, we come once again to your throne of grace and mercy. But Lord, we want to just say thank you for another day's journey. Lord, and I'm glad about it. But Lord, first I just want to say thank you for the forgiveness of sin. Realizing all have sinned and come short of your glory. All of us have missed the mark. Lord, we said some things. Lord, we've been some places. Lord, we entertained some thoughts that was not right in your sight. But Lord, you said, if we confess our sins, you're faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So, Lord, just like David said, create in me, Lord, a clean heart. And, Lord, would you renew a right spirit within me? Lord, with a right spirit, we can worship you in spirit and truth. In the right spirit, Lord, we can lift up holy hands unto you. In the right spirit, we can open up our minds and our mouths and give you all the praise and all the glory and all the honor that you deserve. Lord, in a right spirit, Lord, we can say that this is the day that the Lord has made. And Lord, we're going to rejoice and be glad in it. Lord, we thank you, Jehovah Jireh. You are our supplier, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that we still got a roof over our heads and a floor underneath our feet. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for your grace. Lord, it was grace, your grace that woke us up this morning. Lord, it was your grace, Lord, that gave me activities of my limbs. It was your grace, Lord, you clothed me in my right mind. It was grace, Lord, when I went to my cupboard, I still had food to eat. Well, Lord, and I thank you for the food, but I thank you for an appetite that if I wanted to eat, I could eat. Lord, thank you, Lord, for being with us in this day. Holy Spirit, we invite you into this service. Come on in. Somebody needs you this morning. Come on in, Lord. Sit down beside us. Come on in, Lord. Hold our hands. Speak to our hearts, Lord. Lord, we continue to pray for those that may want to be here, but some reason they're not here, Lord. But I thank you that you're omnipresent, God. You're everywhere at the same time, Lord. I thank you, Lord, and I ask that you stop by the hospital right now in the name of Jesus, Lord. Holy Spirit, we acknowledge that you are our comforter. You are our guide. You are our counselor. Stop by, hold somebody's hand. Speak like only you can. Tell them everything is going to be all right. Speak and comfort those that loved one may be in the hospital and they can't go and be with them, Lord, in the name of Jesus, Lord. Lord, we ask that you stop by prison walls this morning. Remind them you said you would never leave them nor forsake them, Lord. So, Lord, I just ask right now, you have your way in this place. Have your way with it's me. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. So we come and we give you glory. We give you the honor. It is in that name that is above every name. And that name that knees shall bow and tongues must confess that Jesus is the Christ, our Lord and Savior. Would somebody in here say amen? Amen. Amen. Amen means it is so. Amen. God bless you.
Yeah. not dismayed. Whatever betide, God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love abide, God will take care of you. God will take care. God will take care of you. God will take care of you through
there's a word from the Lord. Amen. You have your Bibles now. I can mess up. Matter of fact, I will mess up. Amen. So it's good to have your Bible and read it for yourself. Amen. Quiet. Praise to you. Say, it's going to get better. All right. All right. All right. So Pastor, you messed up. I said, yeah. I don't have no excuses. It wasn't my glasses. Amen. Amen. It's going to get better. Hallelujah. Amen. I needed that. Lord have mercy. There's a word from the Lord coming from the gospel as recorded by John. John, the fifth chapter. Amen. I'll be reading from the King James Version this morning. Amen. Amen. When you're there, say amen. Amen. You need a little more time, say wait a minute. Amen. All right. Amen. Whew. Let's read in unison this morning, John, the fifth chapter, starting at verse 1 through verse 9. Amen. Hallelujah. And it reads as this, all together. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is at Jerusalem, by the sheep market, a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. And in these laid a great multitude of who had infirmities 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he said unto him, "Will thou be?" The impotent man, "I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool. But while I'm coming, another step down before me." Jesus said unto him, "Rise, take up thy bed, and walk." And immediately the man was made whole. Amen. I just like to tag this text with your prayers, but above all, with God's presence. No more excuses. You may be seated. No more excuses. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Look, when you study the ministry of Jesus, you will hopefully notice that Jesus often went to places that some would consider to be off limits to somebody with his reputation. Now, I say this because when some people, when they become known for greatness, they have a tendency to stray away from places that are less than great. But Jesus. Come on, somebody. But Jesus, my brothers and sisters, was nothing like that. When you look at Jesus' ministry, it was almost seemed like the worst of place, the worst of people. Those were the places where Jesus would often gravitate to. I'm so glad about it. Amen. So look. So look in our text this morning. Look in our text. And we'll see Jesus, he's at a sick place. We see Jesus at the pool of Bethesda. Now let's look at verse 3. Give me verse 3. Now, and it says this, and these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, and withered. Now, according to John, John is the gospel writer, he says, when you look at this pool, here are the kind of people who are there: blind, lame, and paralyzed. Jesus shows up to a sick place. Now, not only does Jesus shows up to a sick place, he shows up at a superstitious place. See, one of the reasons why many people were gathered at the pool called Bethesda is because there was a belief or a superstition that said that periodically an angel would come down and would stir up the pool water. And the first person who entered that water would be healed of their physical dilemma. Now, I will say this because if you look at different translations of the Bible, that verse is not in there. So what I'm saying, there is no proof in ancient history that this belief or this superstition was actually real. So listen to me. The lesson that we can learn today is this, that life predicaments may seem difficult to followers of Christ, but we must fight off the temptation to live life hopelessly or live our lives placing hope in nonsense. Yes. Yeah. Jesus arrives at the pool of Bethesda. And look, he's there. And Jesus, he fixed his eyes on a man who has been there for some time. The text says, he's been crippled or he's been paralyzed for 38 years. As Jesus catches this man's attention, he goes up to him and says, look at verse 6. Y'all, look at verse 6. When Jesus saw him lie and knew, now you know Jesus is omniscient. He knew that he had been now a long time in this case. He said unto him, "Will thou be made whole?" Or do you want to be healed? Now, it seems to me the question that Jesus asked that man could be seen as insensitive. The man has been at this pool for 38 years, and Jesus, you know that. He's crippled or he's paralyzed. Of course this man wants to be healed. Of course the man wants to be made whole. But I believe that Jesus is asking this question because everybody that is sick don't necessarily want to be made well. Everybody that's sick don't necessarily want to be healed. Do you really want to be healed? Do you really want to be made whole? Do you really want the best for your life? See, the truth is that there are some people who are living in dysfunction, and they don't mind staying in dysfunction. There are some people who are living in poverty, and they don't mind staying in poverty. There are some people who are living with nasty and bad attitudes, and they don't mind dying with that nasty and bad attitude. The truth is that everybody who is sick don't necessarily want to be made whole. Jesus said, do you want to be made whole? Do you really want better for your life? Do you want to get well? Or do you just make excuses? There's many people who do not want to get well. Why? Because they don't want to change. Why? Because with change, there's going to come a commitment. With change, there has to be consistency. Look, come on to verse 7. Come on, help me. Go to verse 7 right quick. Go to verse 7. Go to verse 7. Look here. Go to verse 7. The impotent man answered him, "Sir," there's some commas there, "I have Listen, I have no man. Y'all know we about to go. When the water is troubled, to put me into the pool. But while I'm coming, another steps down before me. The problem I have with this man's response, he don't answer the question. The question Jesus asked, do you really want to be healed? Do you really want to be made whole? Do you really want the best for your life? And that question deserves an either yes or no. Yay or nay. You know what he started doing? He started making excuses. There's a writer by the name of John C. Maxwell. Y'all heard of John C. Maxwell. He wrote several books on leadership. Invest in him. John C. Maxwell wrote this. The reason why a lot of people live stagnant lives is that they have high hopes and they have bad habits. And one of those bad habits that people struggle with is making excuses. Come on, don't get quiet on me. Come on. Some of us, look, I don't preach to you and y'all. It's a us and we. Some of us are professional excuse makers. Some people have excuses for almost every area of their lives that is not going well. Okay, let's give it an example here. Some students have an excuse for not doing well in school because the teacher is not teaching well enough. Come on, somebody. How about the absentee father? His excuse for not being present in his child's life is because he got crazy baby mama drama. Look, okay, what about the out of shape person? What about the out of shape person excuse is for not working out is they don't have time to work out. But they sure enough had time to go to Crispy Chicken, amen, Five Guys, and Texas Roadhouse. Come on, somebody. Help me, Reverend. Help me, Reverend. The person who is socially irresponsible, their excuse for not voting is my vote don't count. But for some reason, when things don't go right, there's the first one complaining. I don't like this and I don't like that. But the matter of the fact is that maybe some people who are in office is because you didn't vote. You said your vote didn't count. Your vote do count. And we all need to go to the polls and vote when the opportunity is given to us. Please vote. Encourage your children to vote. Your grand, even if they're not old enough, talk to them the importance of voting. That people died for that right for us to vote. Many of us are professional excuse makers. We have high hopes, and we got some bad habits. Many of our lives, many of us live our lives making excuses. Look, one of my mentors, he said this. Look, he said, excuses are the tools that the incompetent use to build bridges to nowhere and monuments to nothing. You're messing me up now. Come on, somebody. Huh? He said, excuses are tools that the incompetent use to build bridges to nowhere and monuments to nothing. People who make excuses, they often live their lives going nowhere. Y'all read my notes. Think about all the excuses you are making in some area in your life and ask yourself this simple question. And the question is, where is it taking you? Okay, I'll answer it for you. It's taking you absolutely nowhere. Brothers, if we're going to overcome excuses in this next season of our lives, you have to do all you can to follow God's leads and not your limitations. Come on, help me, somebody. Look, let's go to verse 8. I'm trying to do better today. Go to verse 8. Look at verse 8. Here it is. Jesus said to him, rise, get up. Take up thy bed and walk. Right there in verse 8, there are three directives. Y'all see it? The first directive is what? Get up. Take up your bed, and what's the last one? And walk. Get up. When I hear that word, I think of my mama. Get up. My mama didn't allow us just to lay around and sit around all day long playing games. Get up, somebody. You're getting on my nerves. Laying around playing games all day and all night. Get up. Take out the garbage. Get up. Wash the dishes. Get up and do something with your lives. Ooh, y'all getting, I'm getting hot flashes. Get up. What Jesus is aiming here is not just body, but his faith. See, life predicaments may seem difficult to followers of Christ, but we must fight off the temptation to live life hopelessly or live our lives placing hope in nonsense. What am I talking about? That man, let me pause this here. That man, look at the picture. Jesus is standing there, right? Yeah. He's looking at the man, and he says, do you want to be healed? Do you want to be made whole? Do you want to be delivered? And the man, he started talking about the water. Angels. Or some other man. Where is your faith? Is your faith in the water? Y'all pray for me. Wait a minute. Is your faith in the water? Is it in an angel? Or is your faith in another man? Oftentimes, there's a saying, desperate times call for desperate measures. Oftentimes, I'm up at night, and there's some guy, he comes and say, do you want a miracle? Well, send me $1,000, and you get some miracle spring water. Desperate times bring about desperate measures. Here, get a bottle of oil. Everything be all right. One guy had a piece of wood chip. This came from the cross. You want a miracle? This is what I didn't understand. The man was standing there. He's laying there at the pool. And here it is, the miracle worker, Jehovah Rapha, is standing right there. And you're looking at the water. Jehovah Rapha right there. You do know God is a healer. But you're looking at the water. You want miracle spring water. You want some oil. See, but you got to understand this. They are symbolic. They are symbolic. Yes, they are in the Bible. But if you are living a faithless life, a disobedient life, you can have as much oil as you want. All you're going to be is nasty, greasy, and oily child of God. Give me the $1,000. In this time, brothers and sisters, it's rough out here. Desperate time calls for desperate. Where is your faith? Some other man carried me to the pool. Lord have mercy, I got the pause again. You're looking for your miracle from, stop it. Some other man. If I could just get a man, any kind of man, he looked like a man, somebody else's man, somebody else, some man to carry me, to marry me. You think because, oh Lord have mercy, you marry this Negro and he gonna make a way for you? Bad habits. Desperate times bring about desperate men. I'm getting old. Desperate times bring about desperate men. I just got to have me a man. And you don't even bother to have him to fill out an application. Did you read his resume? Is he saved? He's spiritual. Yeah. He may be just saved from the waist up. Look, okay, wait a minute. A man to carry me. Do you really want to be healed? Do you really want to be made whole? Do you really want the best for your life? If so, you have to trust God. You have to trust God, and trusting God is not always an easy task. Sometimes God calls us to trust him in the face of some very paralyzing situations. Faith in God sometimes says, I got to obey God's voice to get up in some areas of my life where I may have lost strength. Faith in God. Faith in God, it sometimes says, I got to get up and fight for a relationship that is struggling in this season of this quarantine. Faith in God, somebody. Faith in God sometimes says, I got to get up and fight against injustices that are continue to plague black and brown people in these not yet United States of America. Faith in God, somebody. Faith in God sometimes says, I got to obey God's voice and get up in some areas of my life where I've lost strength. You got to get up. You got to get up. And I could be honest and I could be transparent. I'm an open book. There are some places in my life where I felt I've lost strength. There are some places that were in my life where I felt paralyzed. This is the word I'm going to preach to me this morning. And I could be honest about it. I can be transparent to you this morning. As a pastor, as a preacher, as a man of faith, I've gone through some moments of weakness. I've gone through moments in this pandemic when I wrestled with depression. I struggled with anxiety. I struggled with not wanting to pray. I struggled with not wanting, oh God, read my Bible. I struggled not wanting to preach. I have struggles in my life. I've wrestled not wanting to do ministry. I've gone through some paralyzing moments in this pandemic. I miss the people of God. I miss the young people. I miss them coming to my office. I miss them hugging me and talking to me. I've been struggling in this moment. Oh, but I'm so glad. I had a little talk with my father. Father, I stretch my hand to thee. No other help. I know if thou withdraw thyself from me, where will I go? I'm so glad. I serve a God that hears and answers prayer. My father, he told me, he said, son, don't live your life being so afraid of death that you refuse to live. Brothers and sisters, faith in Jesus, it would do three things for you and me. One is this: God will shield you from that virus. And I ain't talking about this. God can and God will protect you. God will heal you from this virus. God will also seal you. Because your faith in Jesus Christ. Now, you may die from the virus, and it may affect your body, but hallelujah, it can't touch my soul. My soul. My soul. My soul is anchored in the Lord. Oh, I love the hymn. Be not dismayed. Whatever the time, God will, I know that he will. God will take care of you. My father was telling me to get up. And brothers and sisters, every day that the Lord wakes you up, you ought to get up saying, this is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad in it. I'll let nothing or nobody disturb my peace of mind. I'll let nothing. I'm not gonna let the enemy steal my joy. I'm not gonna let the enemy take my peace. I'm not gonna let the enemy destroy my praise. I am not gonna let the enemy kill my worship. This is the day. We are more than conquerors in Christ Jesus. I may not know what tomorrow holds, but I know who holds tomorrow in his hand. Get up. Get up. Then he went and he said, when you get up, take up that bed. Why would he say that? Because all of us have a tendency to backslide. If you left it there, you will backslide and go pick up them old habits, pick up them old relationships, and pick up them old attitudes. Pick up your bed and walk, and when you got it with you, that bed will remind you where you came from. It will remind you what you've been through. It will remind you to where you are right now. And then I could say, if it had not been for the Lord, who was on my side, where would I be? Get up. Take up your bed and walk. I can hear the man say, it's been 38 years, but there is a possibility that I may fall, I may stumble, but understand your biggest excuse in this season may be that every time I try to walk, there's a stumble. Yeah. My excuse me, every time I try to work on that relationship, there's a stumble. My excuse, every time I try to do the will of God in my life, there is a stumble. But let me encourage you this morning that stumbling sometimes is a part of the process. You got to understand stumbling and use your failures as a stepping stone into your future. Walking by faith, you may stumble, you may fall. Walking by faith, it means sometimes you will miss the mark. Yeah, walking by faith, it means you will make mistakes. But through it all, I've decided I'm not going to let my failures to keep me from walking in my destiny. I've decided to follow Jesus all the day long. I decided mama don't go, daddy don't. I decided I'm going to follow Jesus, brothers and sisters. And understand that sometimes we got to read scriptures, come to Bible study, because sometimes our view of Jesus is too successful. We talk about the success of Jesus, but rarely do we show his struggles. Come on, Bible students. When you look at the ministry of Jesus, you will see some struggles. Jesus was born to a teenage unwed mother. This is not a picture of success. This was a picture of struggle. Yes, yes. Jesus being raised in the ghetto called Nazareth. This was not a picture of success. This was a picture of a struggle. Come on, somebody. Jesus, he went out there and he picked 12 thugs. He picked 12 hood rats to be his disciple. This was not a picture of success, but it was a picture of struggle. Jesus, my Lord and my Savior, he was beaten with a cat of nine tails. This was not a picture of success. It was a picture of struggle. Jesus walking down the street of Della Rosa's, he was nailed to the cross. He put nails in his hand. They put nails in his feet. This was not a picture of success, but it was a picture of a struggle. He died. Didn't he die? And you know I'm a Baptist preacher, I got to say it three times. He died. Didn't he die? He died. Didn't he die? But early third day, Sunday morning, he got up. He got up. He got up with power. Heaven and earth is in his hand. And because he got up, he pulled me up, and now, I said now, unto him, he's able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before his presence with exceeding joy to the only wise God, our Savior. be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forever. Can somebody say amen? Can somebody say amen? No more excuses. No more excuses. Jesus paid the price. To him I owe. No more excuses, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. No more excuses. The Holy Spirit is moving in this place. No more excuses. He's calling on you to come. No more excuses. If you want to be saved, believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins. Confess in the Lord with all your heart. He died, and if you believe, if you confess with your mouth, thank you, Lord, the Lord Jesus, and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. No more excuses. Come to Jesus. No more excuses. He's waiting on you. Right now, the door of the church is open. There's one door, and there's one way. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. Is there one? Get up. You may be there watching on this live stream or recorded video. Get up. Not just bodily, but get up mentally. Get up spiritually. He's waiting on you. And you may say, preacher, I'm saved. Have you been baptized? We will baptize you in the name of Jesus. You say, well, I'm saved and I'm baptized. But do you have a church home? I recommend this place. But I tell you, this is not a perfect place. Because we said the church is the hospital. And there's some sick folk in here. And I'm number one. It's not a perfect church. Why? Because we don't have a perfect pastor. But we serve a perfect God. Serve a perfect God. So I want to encourage you. The door is open. You can call us at area code 209-833-7258. And I will receive you. May the church say amen. Amen. You say amen again. Amen. Say amen like you mean it. Amen. Amen. Thank God. Amen. I have a little notice. And next week, right, we will have drive-through communion. But those that don't feel comfortable coming in, it's all good. And those that feel comfortable coming, I will serve you here. Amen. If you don't feel comfortable coming here or driving, I'm sure that you have your packet of elements at home, and we will partake together. Amen. Or at home. Amen. God is good all the time. So right now, I'll ask that we stand for our benediction. Stand for our benediction. After the benediction, the ushers will come and escort you out. Amen? Amen. Amen. Benediction, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Ghost be with you all. Amen.
For those who have asked how to pay their tithes or give an offering, we have three ways. The first is the church website at pocbaptist.org. On the home page, you would scroll down and look for Give Online. It's safe and secure. Just follow the steps. The second is you can mail in a check or money order. No cash, please. The church address is 11473 West Larch Road, 95304, or by text to 209-822-2009. Also, we still have church office hours during the week. You can give us a call and just let us know that you'll be dropping off your tithes. The phone number is 209-833-7258. I'm praying for this world, and I know without a doubt that this too shall pass, and God is still in control. God bless you.